Hi, I'm Em, and this is Fang Farrier. Today, where do broken dentists go? So I've been a broken dentist and I didn't know what to do or how to fix myself or if I could ever work in dentistry again. And there was a lot of kind of, well, where do I go from here? How do I use this incredibly specifically vocational degree to do something else that manages to avoid the things that I didn't enjoy about what I had been doing? Because most of the applications of our degree and what we've done and our learning and our experiences are within kind of similar medical fields or somewhere else within the realms of dentistry. But I just didn't know what to do. And when I came back into dentistry, one of my first jobs and then inadvertently another job down the track, I ended up taking over from a dentist who was struggling and ultimately left both the jobs I was taking over from. And just again, that kind of what happens to someone that keeps finding themselves incompatible with the jobs they have and struggling to fit in and meet the demands of what dentistry is requiring of them, kind of beyond the technical ability to be a dentist, beyond the diagnostic side of it and the stuff we get taught at dental school. What if they're not managing with the stress of dealing with people in such kind of close quarters, the emotional component of that, the charged kind of negative interactions around money, and that again can kind of have us questioning the worth of what we do, which might sound silly if you're not someone that's ever thought about that, but it can be a problem. So I quite often at these, you know, jobs, I will come across notes from previous dentists that I know have struggled and have kind of disappeared from dentistry or made some kind of major changes. And I often wonder what happens to them because I don't know them personally. Where do broken dentists go? And there's a song by a band that I love called Pulp, which is off an album called Different Class, I think it is, which was one I used to listen to a lot at uni. And there's on one of the tracks, as they go down to it, as it gets to the end of the track, it's there's this place in Soho where all the broken people go. And it always makes me think, where do broken dentists go? What happens to them? And why are we losing them? So not, I mean, I know I've talked about kind of mental health and depression and suicide. And yes, that's unfortunately where we do lose some of our colleagues too. But I'm thinking more of the dentists that just, it sounds horrible to say fade away, but they just kind of disappear, drop out of jobs. It can be shortly after uni, can be in the middle of a career, can be just suddenly disappearing at the end and just kind of retract then from the whole world and anything to do with it. And how do we help them? Or how do we prepare people to not be in that position? Because, as I say, we can be broken by so many things. We can be broken by patients and their high expectations and how society is driving them more and more to complain or sue, or the culture of that kind of side of it. The fact that we are the, as I've mentioned in the last podcast, kind of you know, the dark side of medicine. It's kind of the side that we that people distrust and don't have the same faith in as some of our other medical colleagues. Yeah, it's just it's difficult to kind of fathom. But there's also the system, the fact that we are a healthcare provider working for the main part within a business and commercial kind of framework, in that certainly here in New Zealand it's not government funded at all, yet patients will compare our costs to that of the doctor or the physio or whoever, and not really appreciate there's government subsidies behind some of those treatments, which is keeping the patient costs down, which we just don't see on our end at all. So it just makes it a different proposition altogether. And the fact that there's that kind of conflict of needing to make a commercial profit, because without a profit a practice won't run. Without a profit you can't pay your staff. Without a profit you can't further yourself in continuing education. But then money's almost a dirty word around this. Again, I've talked about that side of it, and particularly coming from a country where there is a heavily government subsidized service, which then casts a worse light on those that have chosen not to do that, because it does have an awful lot of limitations, and pursue kind of private dentistry. And it can be a difficult system to work in. So whether you're working within a government subsidized system that's accountable for all sorts of other numbers and kind of stats and figures and benchmarks, or whether it's that you're in a totally private practice and trying to keep everything to a point that you can keep up with the building, keep up with your materials, keep up with your equipment costs and your staffing costs and your training costs and the list that just go on and on and on with things that need paying for. But sometimes we can be broken by other dentists too. And as a bunch, and again I've mentioned this before, we score quite lowly, or have been shown in studies to score quite low on self-compassion. And that's hard if we can't be compassionate with ourselves and kind to ourselves with respect to all of those things. Then what you find is, instead of self-kindness, you're looking at self-judgment. And this goes back to some of Kristen Neff's work. But if we're judging ourselves against an ideal that's not sustainable or not achievable, or something we've been shown in dental school that's not real world compatible, then rather than being kind and saying we're doing the best we can with what we've got, we tend to be kind of more judgy and say, well, I should be able to do this and I should be able to do that, and these are the standards I should be able to achieve, where it's not necessarily the case that we can. And I guess the kind of the final blow on that is when we feel like we're under threat of being judged by our judiciary systems within our dental councils to be upheld to a standard that's not realistic to be able to achieve every time with every patient in real world practice. And that kind of fear side of it. So, yeah, being broken by the system, being broken by fear of complaints and litigation or just reparations from our own dental councils. But the other dentist kind of side of it is, as I say, if we can't show self-compassion towards our own dentistry, I think it's very easy for us to then judge other people's dentistry in the same, if not harsher, light. And that doesn't mean to need to say that we're necessarily doing it out loud, but I think we have to be very careful in the words that we choose to use when we're talking to patients, because they're not hearing them with the same ears we're intending them to be heard with. We're saying them from a point of view of someone that's got the 5 years, you know, dental school and however many years experience after that, rather than explaining it necessarily as a lay person would want it, because there will be words that we would use, like failed restoration, leaking margins, and it's not that these are inaccurate, but they imply fault, and they and the tendency with the culture and the society we live in is to put that fault at the foot of the dentist. Oh, your fillings failed, your fillings leaking. Not necessarily in the context of, well, everything's got a lifespan and we've just hit the end point of it, and we're looking out for kind of signs of when things will routinely need replacing. Not that the treatment you had 20 years ago for this amalgam has failed, it's just that it's come to the limit of what it can do for you and it's time to move on. But again, these are words we've been taught at dental school, because between dentist to dentist, that doesn't mean much. Say marginal defect or leaking or failed, to a patient hearing it, it sounds like they've had something wrong done to them. When in a lot of these cases, like, as I say, with the example of your 20, 30-year-old amalgam, it's, you know, who could have done something better that would have lasted longer in any other material? So it's, you know, they've actually had a great service done, but the words we've used have left them with a completely different feeling. And we can be the same when talking about other dentists' work, or when we do that first initial exam. And I see this a lot from graduates who have come from countries where there is a higher kind of litigious side of it, or a higher element of either whistleblowing or witch hunting by dental councils and other dentists, is that this kind of fear of, if I don't comment on it or diagnose it or say something about it, then if it turns up at the next dentist and the next dental checkup, then I'm going to be at fault for not having found it or done this. And we've got this kind of strange situation where, and again, I've talked about this before, where we've got patients who are seeing a new dentist every time they see a checkup. We do still have ones that are staying with us and staying with a practice for kind of a lifetime. But again, dentists are moving around more often, so they can stay with a practice for the lifetime, but they're not necessarily seeing the same dentist. And there's been studies done to show that the more dentists you end up seeing over a lifetime, that on aggregate you are likely to have more dental work done, because we're not getting that benefit of watching things or taking into account individual circumstances, or getting the chance to see those nervous patients that were very difficult to work on at first, and we haven't been able to do, you know, our best kind of dentistry that we might want to post and show off to everybody, but we've got through it. And then, you know, 5 years later, they're a model patient, and you don't have any of those problems, but you're not going to replace the filling you've done just because it's not the prettiest, or it's not, if it's functional and it's disease free and it's doing what it needs to do, then yeah, we replace it at the end of the lifespan it's at. But the problem is, if the next dentist picks it up because they've gone on to someone else, they see a patient that's no longer dentally anxious or having any kind of issues, and they're like, well, this is terrible work, that we can do better. And again, it's the words that we're using to describe other people's work, and that kind of lending that compassion to them, to putting yourselves in their kind of position. So again, going back to Christian Neff's work, looking for common humanity versus isolation. So it's not me on my own, it's not them on their own with their problems and this and the other. It's looking at something like that and saying, well, there are times when I've done restorations that look like that on x-rays, that I've done things that I wouldn't be putting in a portfolio of my best work, but I remember that they were the ones that they moved. They were spitting all the time. It was, everything was underwater. They were having difficulties. Just all the things that don't lend themselves to kind of ideal treatment or work. So I think the other thing that we have to kind of be careful of is, and this again, it comes down to the importance of the words we use. So this isn't necessarily with patients. This is with each other, because something that we weren't taught at dental school generally was how to lead, to manage, to mentor, to coach, to train up even our DAs. We've had to kind of, unless you've been someone that's been seeking out sources of education in those areas, is that we've been taught by what we've seen and what's been role modeled to us in terms of how to teach. And unfortunately, some of that has been teaching by humiliation, teaching to a group by showing up who did something wrong and making yourself look a wee bit better, teaching as a group and inviting fellow dentists to criticize each other's work with a view, yes, to improvement, but not training us a language to use when talking about each other and each other's work in a highly kind of critical tone, which again, dentist to dentist doesn't necessarily make a lot of difference, certainly dentist to patient. But some of that can be really demoralizing. I've seen dentists' confidence drop dramatically because of the way they're spoken to on a regular basis by a peer, or the way that they are in very good intentions helped and mentored, is that it can feel quite demeaning or dismissive, or it's just that we haven't necessarily been taught how to do this. It's not that these actions are coming from kind of a bad place on the part of the dentist giving them, or the mentor, or the boss, or the whoever it is, the tutor is working from the assumption that we're all learning in one way, that we're learning the same way that dental school has taught us, and that our way of learning will be, if we can just explain how we learned something, it will be apparent to the other person. And we kind of underestimate the fact that the education sector has this down pat, different learning styles, different ways to do it to get the best out of everybody. But alongside education, we're not taught how to lead, how to coach, how to mentor, how to manage your book and your time, how to manage the career development of your team and all these things. And we're just expected to just kind of get on with it and be good at it. And in a lot of cases, we do a pretty good job, but it can be the cases where it's not so much that we're losing people because they're people like the person I'm thinking of, who I just wonder, gosh, if we'd been able to mentor you in a better way, if we'd been able to find you the right practice to work in where your values and strengths were in line with the rest of the practice, where you would kind of fit in with how that worked, rather than have you in a practice with a principal dentist who's so juxtaposed to your way of working. Or if it's that, you know, it's not so much that, it's just trying to get on with things like productivity, time management, things that, you know, don't fit into a business sense and you're struggling short on, is how do we teach that, and how do we coach that, and how do we do it in a way that we're not undermining people's confidence, and we're not having it received as a shortcoming and a criticism and something for them to rather reflect on in self-kindness. It lends itself into that immediate kind of self-judgment and not good enough, and I can't do this, and I just have to kind of stop and quit. Even if you were to kind of look at it from kind of a training point of view, I mean, the amount of stuff we go through to get to be a dentist, it's just such a tragedy that we can't use that, that we, and I don't think it's that, you know, if you've got through dental school, you're suited to dentistry. It's that we need to be better at bridging that gap between dental school and real world dentistry, and acknowledging that it's not just technical skills and more courses on clinical CPD, but we've got to be nurturing and watching out for the mental health side of it, the motivation side of it, and keeping up a clinician's confidence. Because the, you know, the biggest crash you probably have is coming straight from dental school into the real world. And whilst the best time to manage that is during dental school and preparing these young dentists for real world dentistry, we know there's too much in dental school already. So how do we look after them once they're out? How do we protect the new graduates whilst they're honing in their clinical skills? And how do we prepare them for the other side of their CPD journey, for fostering these skills and tools and things that they can use to manage the stress they're going to encounter, the difficulties they're going to encounter, these extra things that they haven't been taught at dental school that for some people are just a deal breaker and can seem quite overwhelming, to the point of them looking at it and saying, well, if I can't do this, I can't do dentistry. So whilst I'd like to fix them all, and I do wonder where they go, and think of dentists that I know have kind of left quite often in terms of kind of what they're up to or whether they ever came back to it, I think the biggest impact I can have is if that's some way you're finding yourself heading or thinking along those lines, is be kind to yourself. Don't judge yourself too harshly. Remember that you're not alone in this and that there are many people facing the same difficulties. It's not just you or yours to solve. And just being mindful of kind of what we're up to rather than over-identifying with the small minutiae of things. It's not an easy career, but I think it's like anything. Nothing's easy if you don't have the skills to do the task at hand. And it's recognizing that whilst we don't come out of dental school with some of these skills, they are teachable, they're learnable, and they're applicable to everything we do. And we can turn it around into something we enjoy and bring our skill levels up to meet the challenges that we face every day. So hang in there, team. As always, I'm on Twitter at @Fang_Farrier or on Facebook at It's a Dentist Life. Join the conversation. Let me know what's going on. Cheers.